Why is it that when you answer the phone, like, you could be sitting on the sofa doing nothing, staring at the bulb on the wall for 4 hours, and you'll just sit on the sofa, and you'll be grand. But if you answer the phone, you automatically get up, you do a sponsored walk, you check the oil in the car, you go out to the kitchen, you rearrange all the cups, you go through the fridge, you go upstairs, you do a load of washing. Meanwhile, you're all on the phone, like, do you know what I mean? You'd be footing about the house, making a sandwich, buttering a scone. And then somebody will hang up the phone on you and you'll just sit back down to doing nothing. And your outdoor's the same.
I didn't run anywhere, like, I just came up a flight of stairs.
Nobody fucking panic, we're back.
Yeah, he is back. Ladies and gentlemen, this week we have a very special guest, Mr. Michael Brown from Parker.
Sounds exactly like one of our shows.
Well done,
it. Just two claps.
Tub slapper short there.
That's not true, I wasn't there.
Just one boy in the back going, fuck up.
The human metronome, ladies and gentlemen.
I've had them gigs, but.
Them gigs? I miss them gigs.
The gigs where nobody's there?
Yeah.
How do you miss that?
Because they were fucking always. Like, me and Dylan have been doing it since. Like, 13?
13?
13, 14, like. I mean, Dylan's been doing it, like, in
the late 1900s.
Aye.
I mean, I don't.
We used to have to get horse and carriage, the gigs.
I don't ever think about it, but fuck so, man.
Aye, it's mental. Like,
fuck.
But I love them gigs. I always, like, me and Dylan all talk about them gigs fondly. Like,
I miss certain stuff from gigs. Like, I remember doing a gig one time. This was, like, way, way back when I was, like, 13 or 14, and we had a band called Liberty Cry.
Oh, what a name.
Coolest name ever. It was. I remember actually getting
that's like a teenage name for a band, isn't it?
I remember,
what do you want to call ourselves?
Liberty Cry. What was it? Funny, it came from an obsession with libertines. I was like, we had the other word liberty in there somewhere. Yeah. But I remember going on to, like, Getty Images and finding a photo of the Statue of Liberty crying and then, like, printing it out, getting a marker and, like, writing Liberty Cry on the backs of its forearms, like a tattoo and all. I was like, it's a coolest band or whatever. It's fun. Now I just don't care. Now I just write the band name and the font generator. There it is. There.
That's pretty much
my EP cover's the exact same. It's What Can I Do Here Now on Instagram. That looks like a cover, doesn't it?
I've stopped caring about that stuff, but I remember, like, stuff at gigs. Like, I remember doing a gig one time, we had no PA stands, so we genuinely asked the bars, like, you know, in plastic crates the bottles come in, can we have, like, 4 or 5 of them and just stack them up and then put the speakers on top of it?
Hey, if it works.
Hey, it
didn't. I remember going to play Dublin, Whelans, and like, having to bring my own kit now, like, hogging it down, and I forgot the floor tom legs.
You did not leave it on the floor, did you?
No, I stuck drumsticks up on it. I said that low anyway, so it was fucking.
I mean, you say that. I actually went on the other day to buy. Do you know them conversion kits? They turn the floor tom into a kick drum.
Yeah.
You ever seen these?
Yeah.
Do you know how much they are?
Much.
£95.
Fuck,
I think. To just turn your floor tom. I was like, I could just buy a fucking smaller floor tom or a kick drum.
Yeah.
It's madness. And I read the reviews, and your mom was all, this isn't even the full kit. It was all, you actually need, what do you call the yaks that are, like, they go on the side of a rack tom, and it means then you can put it onto the hi-hat.
A mount?
The crash stand. No, that mount. You need one of them as well.
I was actually thinking about this the last
time. That's separate.
Do you know what I would do if I were you? Is I would get 2 long wood clamps, right? The length of the floor tom.
And put them underneath it?
Put them underneath it, and they'll act as a leveler, and then clamp the back of the kick pedal to it.
That is the most white trash way.
To the wood clamps.
Aye, and it'll not go nowhere. No, because the clamp then will sit underneath the hooks on the bottom of the kick pedal, and then the rubber will sit on the 2 rims, so it'll not destroy your kick, and because it'll be 2 flat surfaces, you'll be level.
That sounds like the perfect rim job.
I'm being deadly serious.
It's the most cold you have ever heard.
What we'll do, yes.
What we'll do is we'll get 2 planks of wood, we will, and we'll level it.
2 4x4 and a round of duct tape.
You think I'm joking? It'll fucking
we'll
work.
We'll take a wheels every care.
Do you know a fun fact? Adam used to drum.
Did he?
Terribly.
And had a very, very nice drum kit. But the time I found out he drummed was the funniest thing ever. His band, at the time, were playing.
Feather Heavy.
Were you in a band before Fast Thursday, no?
No.
No?
Fast Thursday was my first band.
Oh, you're welcome.
So it was.
You're welcome.
First gig facing the drummer because I was shitting myself.
I wouldn't turn around.
Really?
He just stood there. Yeah. For
which is quite interesting when you think about where it ended, with a mohawk and me topless shaking me nuts.
We'd just like to interject there to do an advertisement for Carlsberg.
Sorry, there's nothing Jim Beam won't get me to do. He's my best friend.
But the first gig they ever had, they were like, oh, we come and do Soundwest. Now, there was no bass player. It was two guitar players and Adam on the drums. They were called, at that time, you weren't even called Filler Heavy.
Oh, we were. Because I have posters.
When did it change to Indoor Kites?
That was after. That was just me and Connell.
All right, okay.
That's like a great hardcore band name.
I know, Indoor Kites.
Like, no, like DC hardcore sort of thing. Indoor Kites.
But the gig, they got down to do this gig, like coming to our sound in the park bar and no, it's in park. The Bridge House bar in park. And I landed there and I was looking at this bar like, have they got a big room in the back? Or no, there's a giant room in there with a pool table in it. Nope. And the main bar is all there, man. I was all, where's the drums going? He pulled out a poker machine out of the wall. Like a recess in the wall and was all, I'm there, lad. And I was all, what? So I remember I'm getting set up and I remember just thinking to myself, this could not go well. I mean, there was people stepping on equipment in the ring to get past them because the toilets were out past them. And I was like, this has to be the coolest, worst gig I've ever been to.
Do you know what the best thing about the story is?
Mm.
I forgot that happened.
Serious?
Yeah.
That gig, I
have like, I love them gigs. We, like, for whatever reason, we love doing tours in the winter. In seaside towns. When it's dead as darn is.
That's the most hipster fucking thing.
That's the best thing I've ever heard. It's like, oh, I seaside town, fish and chips while freezing your balls off.
Yeah, yeah. And I always lagged on about, like, it'd be like, oh, we're going to tour in November. I'm like, where are we playing? And three. Have we ever told you about Rill?
No.
No? Do you know where Rill is?
Yes.
Yeah, it's in Wales. Like,
yeah.
Like, oh, man, we've played there like four times. And the dead of winter. Like, it's a seaside town.
And nobody sunscreen there. And a beanie.
I love that.
But, like, the first time we played there, like, I can't even mind the name of the bar. And I always drive, so them boys load on, like.
Mm.
And it was me, Dylan, Owen, and Ethan was on that tour. So it was. And we pulled up outside and it was a sports bar.
Class.
So it was, well, we thought it was a sports bar.
Oh, no.
So they loaded all the gear in, then they came back out the car and I was all, what's it like in there? And Ethan was, oh, it's like a fucking Blackbird or something. And Dylan turned around and goes, no, it's not. It's a shithole. And it was what, no, like, and we went down then, and like, obviously using the house kit.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was like a meme. And it was like, oh, the loving meme, like, oh, you're using the house kit tonight. And the boy just opened the door and just a pile of shite fell out.
The best argument we ever had about that was when we were on tour and your mom was like, they were like, bring your breakables.
Yeah.
And we were all no baller. So we brought our breakables. And to him, breakables included
a kick drum, not a rectum.
No, like, cymbal stands and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
And we were like, it's the first time ever, we were like, so hold on, all you have is a kick drum, with no pedal, a floor tom and a rack tom. He's like, I was like, right, okay.
Lethal. Class.
What
I bet you
the
kick drum was sliding everywhere.
So he actually had to ring somebody and be like, can you fucking lend us your breakables? And he was like, this band is landing with their breakables. And for every other gig we were on that tour, the breakables we brought, cymbals, snare,
kick,
and I think we brought a snare stand as well. Yeah, yeah. But like cymbal stands, in my head, do not count as breakables.
I always fire them in just to be safe. Like, I always fire one or two in, like,
To be sure.
I mean, we'd brought everything else. I brought a fucking half stack for the crack and a full-sized bass amp, which...
Oh, when we done the Dagger Mouth tour, man, like... We got a, like, I brought my kit, but because Dagger Mouth were coming over from Vancouver, like, we got to lend the amps and all off the fucking label, and it was like a two-story Ampeg bass amp. It was fucking huge, and we're playing, like, no, like, small venues, like upstairs in Dino's.
Oh, fuck.
But it was like getting that thing upstairs was a fucking nightmare. So it was.
I was in that record label in London.
The
Lil Rockets.
Wasn't no, that's in Sunderland. You're thinking what do you call it?
Rough Trade I was in.
Aye.
It's alright.
Little Rockets in Sunderland. So.
I thought, why did I think I was in there? There was something relatable that I remember. Not really.
Back to, oh, I'm just remembering. No, when we played Rill. Like, this is how rough it was. I went out the back for a smoke, like in the smoking garden, and there was a girl and a fella sitting like just
yes.
5 feet away from me. And
I know where this is going.
No, you no, you don't. No, you don't.
The
no, you
lose. He's watching her.
What? No, no. No, they were sitting chatting. They were out celebrating. They weren't celebrating. They were out having their last night out because your mom was going to jail the next day.
Fan fucking tastic.
Because they fucking like he put a crowbar through somebody's house window. And all. He was standing telling me, "Oh, it's not I smoking fag." And I was like, "Jesus Christ!"
This place sounds class. It's amazing.
The second time we went back, was it the second or third? We don't. I've completely erased it from my memory. Like. But we played one venue, loading out ad venue. There was a bar across the street, and the boy came out and was like, "Are you a band?" You're like, "Aye." And he goes, "Our band pulled out. These want to play." And we're like, "I will load on here now and play here for an hour."
Serious?
This is a shithole.
Class. Do you get paid for it?
No, you get paid an exposure race.
Oh, right.
As you always do.
Our band pulled out. I'd be like, "Aye, 400 quid."
Aye.
I'll be absolutely in. But how do you know so many Canadians? Because just as you said, the dagger mouth thing, I was like, hold on a minute, because they know DOA as well.
Yeah.
Where the fuck did your Canadian connection come about? Because you didn't get that in Sandy Nose.
No. You know, no, I got it in Benningham.
We got it in John Street.
Sat in Sandy some night and somebody goes, "Hey, you want to go to Canada?"
I think Dylan booked DOA's Derry show, I think it was. I think it was through Gareth Lamarack that DOA got in contact or something.
Or Gareth.
I think, I'm not 100% sure, but I think Dylan put on the Derry show and gave them a contact for... like Belfast and Dublin, and then we done that, and then Irish did one, DOA. And then when Little Rocket signed us, Daggermouth were getting back together and wanted to do a UK show, so they stuck us on the bill with them.
That's cool shit. That is cool.
Two great bands, man.
Ironically, we did get a connection for Germany in Benningham's last week.
Oh, was that band Owen brought over?
No, there was Germans... at the back of the room, which I just...
I think they're all staying with Owen.
Is it? Oh, yeah. Is it? I just assumed...
Why does that make a pile of sense?
Because Owen lived in Germany.
Owen lived in Germany for a while.
But they were at the back of the room, and I just assumed they were with like the crowd of the other band, because the other band brought a good crowd.
Yeah.
And I just assumed they were part of it. Whenever your man came up to me afterwards, and he was like, "You guys would go down really well."
I was really hoping you were going to go for the accent, sir. Fuck me, I was buzzing for it. Uns, we think you should come over to our country, yeah? You play the rah-rah-rah music?
Graffiti on the wall.
It was
like... Graffiti on the wall.
Graffiti on the wall. We like it.
Anyway,
that was
a
slow burner.
He was like, "We should come to Germany." He was all, "You should come to Germany. I think you'd sell a lot of CDs." And the minute he said CDs, I was like, "This is the place for me."
Once you know the
circus, they still live in the 80s. I'll be over there handing out cassettes.
I love doing them gigs, though, like a band's like they're kind of old and they're still giving her heaps, like.
Yeah, oh, fact.
And they always, like, it's never like our new record's out. It's always our new CDs out.
It's like our new CD.
You can buy it for $5.99 in the back.
There's a guy in Derry. See what I do the acoustic shows.
Yeah.
Like One Piece. Yeah. There's a guy in Derry, and I'm not even sorry, I'm just going to name drop him, called the Cello Fella.
The Cello Fella.
Right? And he
does... Oh, I've seen this boy at Buscombe.
Yeah, he uses backing tracks and plays cello, right? Yeah. But any time I'm ever playing after him, I don't have to do a 2-hour set, because he will run clean through my time, right? Because one, he never stops when he's supposed to, and two,
playing bars?
Yeah, he'll leave all his gear set up while he goes around and like tries to sell CDs.
What way has he spelled cello?
C-E-L-L-O.
Why?
Because that's how you spell cello.
Aye, but he's calling himself the Cello Fella. I would have went full Derry.
Cello Fella.
Cello Fella.
Or her Cello Fellow.
Cello Fellow.
You know what I mean? Like, why mix the two up?
He's English.
Oh, also, do you know what I was thinking about the last day, right? And I meant, I'm saving this for the podcast because I've been genuinely curious. You know right when you answer the phone?
No.
Right.
Never done that.
Right. Why is it... that when you answer the phone, like you could be sitting on the sofa doing nothing, staring at the bulb on the wall for 4 hours and you'll just sit on the sofa and you'll be grand. But if you answer the phone, you automatically get up, you do a sponsored walk, you check the oil in the car, you go out to the kitchen, you rearrange all the cups, you go through the fridge, you go upstairs, you do a load of washing. Meanwhile, you're all on the phone, like, do you know what I mean? You'll be footing about the house, making a sandwich, buttering a scone.
No.
And then somebody will hang up the phone on you and you'll just sit back down to doing nothing. And your old all the same.
You forgot about the buttered skull and then the time you sat down.
But why is it, seriously, why is it when you answer the phone you just start doing things like they're fucking missions?
I don't.
No, I don't.
You did it earlier on, you answered the phone, took off on a fucking walk out the front.
I walked 4 feet
privacy,
out the front yard.
You want the privacy? Do you know the one gets me, and I've discovered it this week with you? Nobody ever rings me, right? Until I've got no hands to answer my phone. Like, I could be standing smoking at band practice, nobody will ring. I could be in band practice playing, nobody will ring. See, the minute I break down and I've got a handful of like guitars and pedal boards, everybody's ringing. That's my one. Or nobody will ring me all day, and the minute I get on to drive the car, somebody rings. And I'm like, where the fuck were you all day? Yeah. You're a nightmare for it. You seem to ring me at the worst times possible.
Are you a big like pacer then when you're on the phone?
So he rang me, and this is the reason I was thinking about this, is he rang me on the phone one night and I got up and started to do things.
Every time I ring him, I can hear the fridge opening. Every time I hear my ears,
I can't sell a piece on the phone.
And rattling the plastic and all, whatever. And then at a certain point, he'll put you down.
Yeah.
And I'll put you on loudspeaker because he's at something. And you're going, I rang you and you were on the phone to me. And you then afterwards decided to put me on loudspeaker, you prick. And then he'll go, what did you say? Put it to your ear.
The phone as well.
Yeah. My ma's the best one. My ma rings me from her car's Bluetooth, but she only ever rings when I'm in my car. So it's just a pile of, what? What? I've got through a bad spot. What did you say? Losing connection at all. I'm like, fucking hell.
Go through a bad spot and then it goes just the whole Donegal.
Oh my God, this place. Do you know where we are currently? Is like, you've never seen the end of the line for phone lines and I'm serious. For like phone lines and Wi-Fi and all.
Yeah.
This is where it stops.
The box is a mile that way.
Yeah. It starts again a mile out the road. So see, between here and the next mile, they have none.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Fuck them.
That's exactly what I say. It's social housing, so fuck them. I mean,
can't afford it.
Rest is out here fucking flat out paying for everything. Paying taxes and all that crack.
Sorry, don't say that, because he'll come in the middle of the night and take us like John fucking Wick.
Do you hear that one?
The tax man, I mean.
The tax man come to get you.
Donegal, you know the way that your man would have said, the bad man will get you. Donegal was the tax man.
Do you know how many labourers' sons are shite feared of the tax man? As opposed to the boogeyman?
I'm fucking well.
We always thought he was made up.
The tax man?
Aye, just an old wise tale.
That's why he has a suit.
We didn't think he was a thing, like, tax man will get you, bro. No such thing as a tax man.
First time I seen a clipboard in the building side, I shut myself.
Do you mind the day we were working with you at 7 and I actually managed to roast your man? And was the carnival colours, no?
No.
Your man landed on the site, he was obviously like, one of them fucking site inspectors.
Yeah.
And he was all... I was putting up staging, but it was on grass. And we were using like wee bits of blocks of wood to stop it sinking. He was like, no, you want your blocks of wood to be 4 mil wider. And I turned around, looked at his feet, he's wearing brown shoes, and I was all, you'd want to have steel toe caps on while you're on site. And he just panicked, went, and just left, and never came back. I was like, Jesus, he must be really attached to him, brown shoes.
It's a good job he didn't see me up the rigging in a pair of Converse.
Oh, I suppose at work wearing fucking Nike. What was I wearing? Janoskis? Nike Janoskis?
The more I think about it, the more rigging I climb without a harness, I should be dead.
The time I climbed the one in the fucking bunker. You ever in the bunker?
No, I didn't go. I was never on
there. You're not much enough.
The way they done they done it on a down ramp, right?
It looked like a lethal venue.
The stage was built on the down ramp, but the trussum for all the lighting was built like above that on the second level, and it came over the top. But I'm not joking, there was like moles between the ceiling and the trussum. So we used to have to like stand on the ledge and pull the trussum up. Now you have like a 30-foot drop behind you.
Aye.
And I was moving the harness from one side lower, and I'm joking, it fucking moved. And I have never wanted to be wearing brown trousers more in my life. Because I was running down my leg. I was like, now for an hour after, I was just looking out there, just shaking, smoking fags, going, fucking hell, I could have died. Like, the more dodgy shit we done in life, especially with band stuff as well. So I'll make all the fun story last night about the night of the fridge.
I'll kill you. I'll fucking kill you.
What was that?
You
fucking, I was fucking blocked.
You fucking fat bastard brought a fucking money fridge on tour.
Oh, yeah.
And you didn't even plug it in. You obese fucking diabetes wonder licking cunt.
You're a liar. I plugged it in one day.
They what?
They keep me the 12 volt in the boot.
That's, and I distinctly remember the outcome baller turning over.
No.
Did you just camp on tour?
No, we slept in the car.
We argued in the car.
We argued in the car.
We actually, when we were... What town were we in? Was it Wrexham?
Fucking destroyed them.
I think it was Wrexham. We found this, like, I just looked up, like, local fucking, like...
Dumping spots.
Not even camping spots. Like, just local, like, nature areas. And we managed to find one down there first night, slept brilliantly.
Hmm.
Fucking great.
Was that where that video where you climbing up trees?
Yes. Yes. That's exactly what that is.
You know the worst thing is? I was sober doing that too. I just bring the camera out here. It'll be funny.
Second night.
Second night,
one they stayed in there, drove down. I was like, oh, there's a Jeep down here, whatever. I was like, I wonder, will they leave? Drove down. All we could see was this leg hanging out the window. We're down booking. I was like, you're fucking legends. I was like, best not interrupt them. Just turn the car away again.
And I must, like, are you going on tour again?
Yes.
Like, are you just going to follow them at all?
Yes.
How am I doing that? We don't do that. We do it a good bit. Like,
what, acting the cunt for camera?
They had the pandemic.
We had, like, we have a full, like, 48-minute long video on our YouTube of our very first ever UK tour.
I don't think I've ever seen that.
I don't think we put it out for too long. It's fucking hilarious.
I'd like to see that.
Mm. It is great crack, like. But I used to love, like.
You still have your wee weird short hair and all those?
I don't know.
It's weird to put you now with short hair.
This is as long as my hair's ever been.
I know why. You look like a majestic lion.
I don't like it. I want to shave it off again.
Do. Don't let people know what they expect next.
No.
Do like Skrillex. Just start with half it gone. Just shave half it.
Start DJing. Yeah. Busy Joe's.
Hey, see at this point, they probably let you.
Just but you like, land them with iPads or you're the ground.
I have a whole iPhone like 6 in the house, like it is. Like full of all the footage of us recording the Lost Avenue album.
You know you can just save that stuff to a computer. And not
yeah, I don't own a computer.
No, what?
My man, same as me.
I don't own a laptop or a computer. Like.
Why?
Look how happy he is.
I have a phone. Like.
I couldn't cope. I love technology. I own an iPad that I don't use.
Yeah. I want a Mac so badly.
No, you don't.
I do. I just want to record shit.
You know what really annoys me about Macs? Is you buy a Mac and you're like, this is class. And then 6 months later, it's out of date. And you're all, like it's heartbreaking. Like that my Mac's 2015.
Yeah.
And like when I bought it for £800, I think it was. And I seen them on Facebook yesterday for like £300.
Aye.
I'm like, well, it is old now, like it's fucking what, 8 years old.
Yeah.
For any old laptop you would go, oh, that's not old. For that them ones you're like, because Apple starts to slow down their technology.
Oh aye, aye. As soon as they announce something new, like
you
may as well fuck your phone out.
They openly said it, they were like, we deliberately do this to get you to buy the new
business.
Mm-hmm. It's business. Tell me about Canada. I want to know.
You want to know about Canada?
I want to know about the DOA tour. That intrigues me because them boys are like what age?
Oh fuck! They're well up there, like.
And they're absolutely still giving it there, like.
Joe is the oldest.
The two of you need to pause game here.
Wow.
See, before he jumps into Canada, surely he should say, "Well, whenever I was doing X, Y, and Z at this particular time, such and such a band went to Canada to tour, and then break into the story." Context is king.
I was born in 1997.
Thank you, Michael.
Yeah, go ahead, Michael.
They have family of three.
For a man who loves context, ye say some of the most nonsensical shit on the planet.
Who, me?
Him.
Oh, I don't.
Oh, you're on the phone, hey, and you're buttering scone. And the context great there.
Sir, you do. You answer the phone, and the next thing you're outside retailing the fucking wall or something.
You've never retailed a wall in your life.
Sir, I couldn't tile my fucking shoes.
What are you putting tiles in your shoes?
He's dyslexic.
I'm so glad you got that joke. Oh, thank God. Slow burn, Michael.
I was a slow burn. That was a good one.
But when you were in a band, undisclosed name of band, you just went to...
Me, I met Dylan.
Do you know what, actually? I do want to know that story because you were the original drummer.
No.
Weren't you?
Nope. John Goodman was,
John Goodman was the original drummer.
Right.
When it started getting good, you were the original drummer.
I wouldn't say it.
No, when the band started putting out, like, because I think that
when
was
I joined, we started turning pretty heavy.
The first thing I remember was, I think it was called Ethanol, the EP.
That was the first thing I released. First ever thing.
And that was when it started, like, not taken seriously, but that was when it was like, you know.
I think me and Dylan have always, like, I met Dylan through drums. Dylan plays drums.
That's right, I forgot about this.
Yeah, like I met Dylan through like in Blink 182. I was getting drum lessons off a guy called David Whiteside.
Yeah.
And he was teaching me in school, and I walked into the lesson one day, and he was all, "You like our boy Travis Barker, don't you?" And I was like, "Ah, he's classic, he's legal." And David was all, "Here, I know a boy looking for a drummer. Here's his number." And he gave me Dylan's number, so I text Dylan then.
So David Whiteside put your band together, technically.
Yeah, pretty much.
Props to Davey. Fucking hell. Yeah. That's cool as shit.
It was great to be recommended by Davey when I was like 13.
T. Dillon, who was already at it from fuck knows what age, because I remember seeing photos one time. There's no chance of finding them now, but there was a bass player before Jack.
Yeah, it was a. Oh, I can't remember his name.
Big tall dude with glasses and long hair.
I can't remember his name.
I remember seeing photos of me like, what the fuck? And then I think Jack was the guitar player at that point, wasn't he?
Might have been.
There was another guitar player.
But
then there was me.
So I text Dylan, and Dylan was like, "I come on out the shed. Did you?"
I was like, did you play music after that then?
I know, we got on there at the end of it.
I was never in the shed. I've seen photos of the shed, and you're dragging drum kit and all, but I was never in the shed.
Did you not practice in that shed?
No, we done the nerve.
Did you? See, me and Don have only practiced out in them sheds and on his house. Like,
we don't.
When I went out then, Don, we chatted and we just jammed, a few songs. I think the Libertines might have been one of the songs we played, and what do you call it? Feeder? What do you call it? Feeder song?
He's got a brand new
car. That's the exact one. And
that's their only fucking song.
No, they've an R good one.
I'll tell
you. You chat amongst yourself. I'll ask Johnny Google.
Tell you in a minute why I don't like that band.
Right.
Well, why I like them and don't like them.
Yeah. But we toured all that summer then, pretty much.
Jesus.
We were like it was Dylan's dad drove us everywhere. Yeah. The funny thing, like we're meant to be doing Cork in a few weeks' time, and I have to go somewhere after the show, and Dylan was like, I'll see if my dad can drive us down and drive us back up, and I was like, I'm fucking raging that I'm not going in that car.
With Jeff.
Because it's such a throwback. Like, no, we were saying like,
why would Dylan not drive it?
Dylan doesn't have a car anymore.
Oh.
So then. But that's why I love all them shows, because it was Dylan's dad driving us now, and then there were shit shows. But I was only in the band then for about less than a year, and then I left. And that's when All Yous Boys came in, then like Dalta and
I make us sound evil. Like, all Yous Boys and landed on that. Well, I actually me and Dalta got in by accident, because Dylan, I was busking or something in the street, and Dylan walked past, and as you mentioned before, the really weird thing, and me and Dylan talked about it when he was on as well, was like every member of Lost Avenue was in the same room at the Julius Lambert show.
Like every past, which present, is and future.
The
ever.
Weirdest thing ever.
So weird. Me and Ethan went to that show. Now that I think back on it, was very crafty from Dylan, because he just wanted people on the door, and he was all to me, come to the show and we'll chat at the show. So I had a pay to get in the show.
I don't even know if I paid.
No, I don't think I did.
I don't think I did. Was the nerves out there all the pay?
We were out the front then, and Dylan handed me the second ever Lost Avenue EP.
With the white cover?
No. There was one before Ethnol. There was one before that.
And I had them all at one point.
Yeah, but he gave me one. I think they called it Beggar at Home.
That's exactly what it was. Yeah. And I know that song.
Yeah. Dylan gave me that CD and was like, there's a couple of songs they learned.
Yeah, because he gave me all them as well. Because it was Beggar at Home, and there was something before that as well.
Yeah, he'll never let you listen to it.
No.
I haven't even heard it.
The Beggar at Home or the other one?
The one before that.
I have it somewhere.
I've never
down there. I'm not even kidding.
Because they're
in that CD collection down there. I have that somewhere.
Because the only two things I done with them in was we done Ethanol, and then Introducing Hal.
Introducing Hal, Jesus. Yeah. Alright, always forget about that. Was Canada as well, was it?
No.
Where was that?
That was here, just
fucking Canada gooses.
You were definitely away somewhere.
We went to Dublin.
Dublin.
Right.
Well, that's when we joined. Like, I remember seeing the band, and then I had heckled Dylan in the street or something one day. I was busking, he was walking past or whatever, and do you know what you do? You're just, well, as I do, you're just like, hey, sir, have you ever seen anybody in the band? And
he just walked past with top hat and all.
He took it seriously.
And leather vest.
I hadn't put the top hat on at this point yet.
You weren't christened yet?
I'll tell you how this will give you a laugh. I'll tell you how the top hat came along. He was like, I had said this, and it just walked along, and him and the drummer at the time, who then became the drummer.
Yeah.
And I got a text from him, and he was like, we need a bass player. And I was like, I fucking own a bass. Let's do it.
Hmm.
So we got together like once or twice, and I was like, I don't really like playing bass. What about two guitars? I was like, I'll play guitar as well.
Right. You were like a five piece at one stage?
Four piece? And he was like, who would play bass? And I was like,
I know the guy.
I've got a guy.
I've got a guy.
So Dalto, actually, at the time, was like, I don't want to play bass. I'm a guitar player.
Yeah.
Guitar player, I don't want to play bass. Ended up playing bass, and ironically then...
was one of the best.
Fucking, I was one of, turned out to be one of the fucking best bass players you've ever seen. Like, yeah. But that was how I ended. And then I left. I can't even remember where.
But you done an album, no?
We did.
Yeah.
We done...
Where'd you record it?
The Nerve Center.
Oh, in that wee studio?
In that wee tiny, tiny studio.
That's where we done our two EPs as well.
And I'll never forget it, because there's a song that was on that called Two Bottles.
Yeah, I know it well.
And you can hear Delta talking at the start of it, because the guy that owned the studio, his mate gave him a bass, a Fender Precision bass, and you know, like the scratch plate on the back of it?
Yeah.
There was a very, very HD photo of the guy that owned its knob, right?
I love that.
Sellotaped it, and the condition of him loaning him the space was that this sticker had to stay. So on the start of the song, we hear Delta going, "There's a dick on the back of my bass that I just kept tight." And it was like one of the things we were like, leave it on.
Yeah.
Leave it on. But I remember like the drum kit in there and all was electric and all that. And when I came across a memory on Facebook last day actually of me, because I have that CD somewhere as well.
Yeah. I never had the CD. I just listened to it. I think we had it on SoundCloud or something.
Did we?
don't tell me, Anna.
I don't know, looking for it.
I don't know if it's still up. Like,
I could actually probably nearly play Beggar and a Thief, you know, now that you mentioned it.
Beggar and a Home Race.
Beggar and a Home. Do you know why I say Beggar and a Thief?
Joker and a Thief.
Stereophonics. Barman and a Thief.
Right.
But that's how I ended up on it. Like, it was, you know, it was an accident. And then I genuinely can't remember when I left, but I did get very into top hats and drinking warm. That's a good one.
If Dylan hadn't asked me back to rejoin that band, I don't think I'd be playing.
I was going to say, how did that even, like, did he text you and was like, "Michael, please come home"?
I was on holidays.
You were on holidays and he was just like, "Do you fancy?"
I was on holidays because me and Dylan's always been friends.
Ah.
Like, no, I don't call him. Like, he's my brother. Like.
Brar.
He's my brother.
Brar.
Like, I
love you, bro.
I do time for him. Like.
Brar. You do a stretch, would you?
As I said before, you'd murder me and Barry and ask no questions.
Oh, yeah.
Like, when we were in. When was it? I was on holidays and I brought him back a pile of tobacco. So it was
you're doing a fag run for the rat.
No, I just brought him back a few pouches of tobacco, like, and then
a few I had.
And I landed back that day and went out to his house to give him, like, to give him the tobacco and all. And I think they were literally just starting a tour. They were just starting a tour, and Dylan was all, "I need a drummer," and I had played with him anyway because there was a few times over there I would have stood on, like, Dylan always asked me to stand in for a few gigs if the R drummer couldn't do it, and he was like, "Oh, I fucking need a drummer." He was like, "Do you fancy doing it?" And I was just off a plane, like, 5-6 hours.
What age were you?
Then?
Yeah.
I don't even think we were 18.
Yeah, because I don't feel as bad about it now that we were very young, because I had been in the band and followed the band or whatever. You coming back was big shit.
I don't think it was.
Oh, it was? It was like, fucking Michael's coming back. Yeah. Oh, fuck.
No.
Because everybody at that point had seen you drum. Like, anybody that ever...
very good back
then. Yeah, but anybody that ever listened to that band was Ipchy at style, but...
Yeah. Anybody got away from being shite from just hitting really hard.
Yeah. Yep.
Look, Sharky. Look, I'll tell you the exact same thing. Looks like, might be the best drummer, but by God, I can break stuff. Yeah.
Hey, fucking disintegrate symbols, the wee cunt.
I'm the same, man. I'm the same.
No, I mean, I've never seen anybody break stuff as hard in my life. Apart from Limp Bizkit.
What a band.
Damn
it. Amazing. But I got back from holidays and just jumped in the car with Dylan, Delta, and Jeff, and we.
And just left?
And just left.
I love that. That's cool. That's the kind of attitude you need in life.
Well, me and Dylan have always been like, you have to tour.
Tour, honestly. It's the most hell for us anyway, right? It was hell in a handbag.
No, do you know what the problem with me and you in tour was? Me and you run it together.
No, I'll tell you what the problem was. Every time I go to speak, you chat.
I haven't opened my mouth in about 20 fucking minutes because you two old goats are going back over war stories.
Back over the glory days.
Right?
When you've been travelling,
I'm
going
to interject now to get a giggle,
no.
So you just can go back to Dylan things again.
No, we were at that Battle of Bands last night. Did we ever tell you about the time we done a Battle of Bands in Wayland? In Dublin, and they had a clap-o-meter. They decided they want a band.
Unbelievable. Can I just stall that for 2 seconds? Yeah. While we were in a band, you were turning turf, you fucking donkey. Go on ahead there, Michael.
I never turned turf in my life, although I wish I had, because I'd be a better man for it.
Hey, they're banning it.
Turf?
Turf?
I'm pretty sure they're banned.
What?
Sorry, this is... Fuck your story. Go ahead. Somebody get Google about the turf.
This is more important. This is Donegal.
My house is going to be freezing. My mother's going to die of hypothermia.
I'm making don't quote me on that. I'm making you a burger after this. We say the turf. Anyway, they had a clap-o-meter.
Clap-o-meter? The band that got the loudest clap.
If that matters in house too.
But we...
I had the loudest clap.
But we...
Red rat.
I remember...
Your cock's got around the applause.
Like, we were running around telling everybody as soon as the shout last on you, don't clap.
Don't clap?
Don't clap.
Why?
Because we just wanted to play Dublin and get a bit of recognition. Like, we weren't down to one band.
We wanted to play if we don't want to come back.
Well,
it wasn't that night, but at an hour time we went to Whelans. Have you played Whelans?
No.
Have you never played Whelans?
Me and Adam have stayed above it.
Have you?
Yeah, we...
So do you know that street
stayed
at all?
Stayed above it.
Do you remember when we went to see Mike M?
Oh, I thought you meant Morley.
Morally, we're fucking not...
I'm not joking. We stayed above Whelans, right, in this hotel, right? And you get in there, it was like fucking 144 euro for two nights in Dublin, which is cheap.
Yeah. I remember now. This was in the midst of me getting sober, right? And I was fighting really hard with the whole putting the bottle down thing. And he quite hadn't grasped how bad my issue was with drink. So he landed over and gave me two drinks. And I says, recently, I probably shouldn't be having these. I've gone ahead, where Mike came, you can have two. And so I had the two. And then proceeded to spend the next 5 hours going to Reese. I think I should go to the bar. No, do you know what? We will go to the bar. No, Reese says, all right. No, don't. You're going to miss the band. And me basically, can I please go get a drink? No, Adam, you can't get a drink. And then we're going to their bed and I'm looking out the window. Whelan's going, Reese, I could go down there for a drink. You know, no, Adam, you can't go for a drink. You're not supposed to be drinking. And he's finally starting to realize why I shouldn't be drinking. Because I'm going on like this at the time. I'm like, Reese, I might just nip out. If you nip out, you're not getting back in. Right, okay, Reese, sorry.
The halls in this place, like, no straight floors. Like something out of Shining, right?
Oh, I've stayed some shit.
We didn't see anybody else that stayed in it. When we went in,
I've shared a bunk in a hostel. We don't.
When we went to our room, there was blood and footprints on the ceiling. And the ceiling was a good 15 foot up, so I genuinely want to know how the footprints got there.
No, it only looked 15 foot to you. It was a 10 foot ceiling like everywhere else.
Yeah, but I was on the
down
slope.
The lamel, so it was no, down no. Lamel.
It was 15 on my end. There was a slope in the floor. But like...
We fucking... You know that street Whelans is on?
Yeah.
That's pure mental. Like, yeah. Like, and you sort of... I always park around the side of Whelans, like you can go around the side and up the wee street. Mm. But when you're going up that wee street, on the left, there's like a wee sort of car park. So we were going down, doing the midnight hour, and the fee is always like 200 euro, like 200 euro or something, or 300 euro. It's pretty good, like. But we had parked in that wee car park, and we were buzzing. It was like a first headline show in Whelans. Like, and Whelans is a big deal when you're like a young band.
When you're band, then.
Yeah, it's a fucking cool venue. And done the show and all. It was all grand. And we came out and Jeff's car was clumped. So it was, right? So we had to ring up to get the clump off. And it cost exactly how much that we got paid.
You got paid. Yeah.
And then we were all, fuck, we didn't know. You get clumped and here and all. And then we were all sitting, we all looked up above the car. There was a big sign above the car, being all cars parked, you'll get clumped. We had parked right under the sign, like, oh, fuck.
You definitely do that again.
I should have took a picture with the sign.
I know.
When we were playing Sheffield Live when we were on tour, and that's what the venue's, isn't it? Sheffield Live?
Maybe it was Love.
I don't know, but the venue, that venue's class for all the wrong reasons.
Yeah.
Like, you go in and there's like a great stage and it's got like barriers and all in the front of it and all. And it claims the Arctic Monkeys played there, but so does everybody. We're in Sheffield. But the thing that got me was like, there's guitars on the wall signed by like B.B. King. Definitely was not signed by B.B. King, but somebody was at it. Like, it was like a left-handed blue guitar that didn't even look like B.B. King's guitar. And it was just like all this stuff everywhere. But it had, do you know the bathroom that every band has been in ever with the stickers?
Yeah.
And it had one of them air, but like, there was a signature in the middle. John Lennon was here. I forgot. I fucking knew. But that place had nowhere to park, and it has a tram that goes through the middle of the place.
Right.
So parking meters are like, shit expensive.
Yeah.
So for us to play that gig, it cost me like 45 quid to park there for like fucking 4 hours. And it was nuts.
That would have been a city. I wouldn't have been allowed to go back on tour again because of parking fines.
Well, would you just got the fine and been like, fuck you?
That's what I was saying. Like, we, our last tour, we had a book, like, Dom was always, I might do here. And I was like, I can't take my car on there. Like,
I never even thought about that. I could have just thought
to go. It really limits where you can go in. It's sort of.
We can pay them. Do you know what I mean?
No!
No!
Fuck them!
No, never going back. Ryland
used to be really handy when I took my mask here on tour because it was a DL Ridge.
Class.
So they were never getting me.
No, we think that. That's where all his fines are coming out.
I've got a lot of fines from out of the state that are coming home. So they're jumping the border and they're coming home with a and post as opposed to the Royal Mail.
But you never told us about Canada.
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 Where? How long is there? The how long was
that year? I'll get that the rundown of that year. That's like the fucking. It's like hands down. Like next day, me Wayne being born. That's like the best time ever. So it was. It was amazing. Like. The end of 2017, when we decided to do an album.
Yeah.
When we decided to do the Lost Avenue album, we had, like, I think we, like, had, we had a couple of weeks to record it, but we had, like, a 2-week tour in the middle of it. So we were, like, studio, tour, studio. And then in 2018, then, we toured for 2 weeks in March. Two and a half weeks in March, 2 weeks in July. We'd done 3 weeks in Canada, and then we'd done a month in Europe.
Jesus.
And it was amazing. Like, and it was all through Little Rocket. Like, the Daggermouth tour was like the March. So we done a week with Daggermouth, I think it was, and then we done a week by ourselves. Like, and the.
Well on your way kind of job.
Yeah, like the Daggermouth guy, we got on really well with Emmons, and then they were just like, anytime he's want to come over, give us a shout. And I think it was the next day we were just like, hey, we're thinking about booking a tour in Canada.
COVID shafted us with the same thing. We were supposed to go to Germany with Fast Thursday, and COVID happened then, and then the band fell apart. Yeah. And it was just like.
Canada was amazing though. Because we were playing all these mad... We were playing these wee small towns where fuck all happens.
Class.
So everybody
was
going
to me, I think me and you had a conversation one time, the biggest gig you ever played and it was Canada.
I think it might have been.
You were saying it was like a big fucking like auditorium?
Oh, no, it wasn't. It was... We played in Ukulele.
Pronounce that.
Ukulele.
Is it Ukulele?
Aye.
Is it Ukulele or Ukulele?
No, well, I don't fucking know.
Well, Dolan Riggins, when Dolan was here, Dolan Riggins, he said it wrong when he wrote the song.
Aye, probably, yeah. I've just been saying what he said. I've been following Dolan for 10 years.
He was all...
You know what I mean? I thought it was Yuslid.
No, he was Yuslid. All... He was all, I called it Ukulit. He was all, on the song, he was all, I think I later found out it's actually Ukulit. He was all, so, it kind of makes no sense.
I don't think one is going to make a difference.
You say that.
But when we play there,
you asked the next girl, you go to bed with.
In the words of my coach, Gareth Vaughan, give her the extra inch. What extra inch, Gareth?
We, was a veterans hall we played there.
So it was massive.
It was like a fucking, it was like a 300-400 cap venue and it was rammed.
Class.
It was like, it was fucking mental. All them gigs, all like, we played a hot dog shop in Vancouver. Like,
what?
I have an important question about Canada.
I'd have never got on stage. I'd have been standing absolutely huffing dog into me.
See, they stopped serving food at the time. Like.
I don't care. I don't want to turn the fryer on.
Are the women good looking in Canada?
I'm not going to answer that.
Why not?
Because I have a girlfriend.
And what?
I'm not going to answer.
Sure, GG drive a Peugeot doesn't mean you can't look out the door at all our fucking Peugeots.
But I do. I like my Peugeot.
That's
my
point.
Peugeot.
Did another Peugeot not pass you in the street? You go, geez, that's a fine me 306.
No, I'd be like, no, my 508's better.
That there's a petrol one. That means your revs higher. She's no good in the low end, though.
Are they as polite as... Do you know the world makes them out to be?
Yeah, Canada's great.
Yeah.
It's amazing. I go back in a heartbeat.
I think what I like about Canada, especially with touring bands, and the difference between Canada and America is you don't need the visa.
You get a visa, but it's significantly cheaper.
Yes. You don't need the American visa where you land with instruments and they go, what are you playing on?
Yeah.
Canada's a lot easier to tour on, whereas America, it's like, I know, you can't take a guitar on. Oh, it's a gun. I think I'll be.
So what you're saying is Canada's as handy to get on this brickwork?
Brickwork's not that handy to get on anymore.
Is it not?
Aye, it turns out if you're 18, they don't let you in. You have to be younger.
Oh, fuck.
Turns out you have to be under 18 to get into that venue. Do you know, that place used to be fucking class, but do you remember Mason's Upstairs?
I worked at Mason's.
Aye, but do you remember playing it all?
Yeah.
Like, Mason's Upstairs was lethal. And then they just turned it into a fucking crash, and I'm just like, it's not in the side down here, but have you played in the 720?
Have I? No, never.
They've basically, because Billy Campbell isn't now.
Yeah.
We played it not that long ago. They've basically rebuilt Masons.
Have they?
It's fucking class. Wireless fucking mixing desk and monitors and trussing and stage lighting and all this here. And I'm just like.
That was where that big massive gig happened a few months ago, wasn't it? There was like fucking.
The Ecoplex.
There was loads of it. Did you just play it?
No, I don't think so.
Remember, it was like loads of bands in the one building.
We played with 9 Foot Lizards and String Cut Puppets. You seen String Cut Puppets last night?
I did. Very good. Yeah. Talent was really good last night.
The what?
The fucking.
So were the bands. I knew I'm going to get you.
The band's really good.
The level of talent last night was brilliant. Yeah. I enjoyed that band that reminded me of a Pink Floyd album, but I'm very ashamed to say I don't remember their name. You know the boys in the floral shirts? At the
Delta Minor?
Is that what they're called? Delta Minor?
Epstein Delta Miners too, boys, to be fair.
Cut that.
I enjoyed their... Like, they don't like all them big guitar swells and all. Yeah. But it would have been infuriating for you because the drums were, like, really light.
No, I'm not mad at it.
Like. I would have enjoyed, like, a Phil Collins but on it. You know, like, it was all really gentle. Just went mad. But, no, I enjoyed them. And I really enjoyed Off Guard. I also enjoyed their name.
The first band?
Yeah. Caught Off Guard.
Yeah.
I like that. Do you know what I mean?
There was good bands last night.
It was, the quality was good. And what as I said, like last night, because Dylan doesn't believe me that I was there just to see the bands and that I wasn't there scoping at the competition.
That's exactly what
I
was doing.
That's not even what I was doing.
Dung, 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 dung,
and the best part was, it wasn't. I was literally just there to see the bands because, as I said to him, see if you'd put a fiver on that door, half them people wouldn't have been there.
Yeah.
Mm.
And I just enjoy going to gigs where there's actually fucking people.
Aye.
But it's a dairy thing. It has to be free.
Or cheap. Yeah. We made that mistake before.
I don't know, I made that mistake many times. I remember charging £3 in the door one time for four bands.
No, we charged pretty dear one time and then nobody came.
Dear?
What?
What do you mean pretty dear? What's pretty dear? Like
a tenner. There was like four bands on the ball there.
£2.50 a band.
What was your launch on a tenner? On the door.
And that's different. They're established now.
That was an album launch.
Yeah.
I can't imagine. No, I think it was £7.
Was it not £7 a ticket and then £10 on the door?
Something like that though. It doesn't matter, we sold out, didn't we?
Oh, hey,
all I know is I hand you a big wedge of money because I left that gig with stickers and jumpers and it was all a great time.
I'm delighted for you, I never went.
I was a lethal gig.
I was not there.
Were you not?
Oh, that was one of them gigs that put a statue in the Horn of Mary.
I was working.
Or a horn in the statue of Mary,
I was working.
Was it fucking unreal?
Is there songs you just want to bring back?
Oh, don't chat to me about it. Like.
From previous bands?
Yeah.
Like,
you know, I'm still trying to convince Dylan to bring back like a Yes Hand song.
Like what? Which one? Move?
No, not Move. I can't even remember the name of it. Like, we used to play it in the set. It was like, we're like writing the album to it at the minute.
And my God, hold on a minute. Is this a rhythm section thing?
What?
Literally what you just said. I can't mind the name of it. Because Jack does the same thing. Jack's a bass player. And I go, right, we'll do like one of our songs. We'll do Klepto. And Jack will go, which one's that?
I do have to tell him all.
And he had to explain the riff to him. And he goes, that one.
I don't know how many times we've been playing live. And Dylan's all to me like, never mass. And I'd be like, which one's that? It's like the first song like we wrote together, the three of us, like me, Dylan and Owen.
I'd love to bring back Drive, one of our Fast 30 songs.
Yeah.
Cause
that's a fucking rough and a half.
That is. It was an accident.
I'd love to play that just one more time, you know, live.
We're writing pretty heavy at the minute. And there's one song from the Gas Hand set that I was like, I'd love to bring it back.
Yeah, I'd like to hear it again. Yeah. But yeah, I worry about it then, because you don't want the two connected.
I mean, nobody gave a fuck about Yes Hand, so.
I did. I thought just, especially when I heard Move, I was like, oh, we're going dark. It's like, we're going dark.
Yeah,
aye. I like the dark.
I like when, like, Dylan's my favourite songwriter, hands down. And I love when he does shit like that.
Yeah.
Like when he gets a like riff out.
Goes mental.
Gets me hard.
Does it? Aye. Just by, is that why you always see the drum lifting?
No, it's my seat.
This is equal further in the floor. You look back, something, it's just Michael's head and two arms.
Yeah. When I get there, if I make it to like 50, I'm going to be hunched over. Like, you know what I mean?
If I make it to 50, if I don't decide that drum is not for me and bricklaying's away forward, you're going to be hunched over anyway if you're a bricky.
Oh, I know.
You're going to be fucked, like. That's why you never got any taller. You're like me. You've been carrying heavy stuff your whole life. I've been carrying my cock around.
The balls are weighing me down. So
I was waiting for that too. I was waiting for that.
No, I like.
I love it. There's bands now, like, and you seen it last night. There's bands now that are writing a whole lot heavier. But you think like 10 years ago, if you'd went anywhere near one of them stages, with a heavy band.
It was all indie bands.
Everybody would be like fucking heavy metal. Yeah. I'm not fucking here for that. And you're going. It's not heavy metal.
It used to be all indie bands. Like.
It was all indie bands. Yeah. Like, it was all like clean guitars and really soft.
See, that's when the Arctic Monkeys started doing all that kind of stuff. Like, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, and then everybody realised that they absolutely destroyed their own career.
I'm not a fan of their new stuff.
Nah, nobody is.
No. I've seen it the last
Instagram. They just go back to like being like a dirty like jeans and t-shirt dandy band.
I do believe that part of the problem is that he learnt to sing.
I have heard this.
Everything's too smooth and clean and croony.
I think a part of the problem is he lost his dirty accent. He had his accent came straight through on songs.
No, right? the main problem is he's a fucking knobhead.
There is that. But the accent, right, originally, right, you hear a bet you look good in the dance floor, right?
Aye.
You kind of figure out he's from Sheffield, right? Aye. Now it sounds like he's putting on a Sheffield accent.
Aye.
Because everything's like, oh, damn, and loving, yeah. Like, he's just, you're going.
My favorite point in the whole thing was like that Love is a Laser Quest era. I think all of that was fantastic.
Do you know how I know they're shite? I have no idea what that is.
Hey, what the fuck's that?
Basically, it was a whole album of him, like, you know, right, the way he's very much himself at the moment. Like, yeah. He's a lot of himself.
Yeah, he loves himself.
This is him at about 75% him, just before it got sick of him.
I was at a party a few weeks ago. No, a few months ago.
And he was there.
Somebody put him on.
Naturally. We were all sitting having a drink in the house and somebody put Arctic Monkeys live on. And they're in between a song, he went over to the bass amp and he lifted a comb up and combed his hair and I turned it off.
A fact.
Yeah, I was like, I'm not watching this. Fact. Comb his hair red.
Like. Do you know what I would like to see? I would like to see one of the band members get thick and just nail him with a guitar or something. Like, just they just had it up.
Get up there.
Like, I'd take the shirt and tie off and go, I've had it.
Aye.
Like, my favourite band at the minute, if you haven't heard of them, you're going to love them. Frank Carter and the Rattlesnakes.
Oh, I've seen them live.
Yeah, so have I.
They supported Foo Fighters, now I went to see Foo Fighters.
Yeah, so did I. Yeah. Michael, were you there?
The Tennis Vital, not, that's like a tennis.
Ah, Tennis Vital thing,
yeah. Quite your road thing.
Ah.
That was class.
How do we not run into each other?
What is it we like?
Me and you run on the tour gigs.
No, like last time, you remember being at the same gigs. We don't know.
We all like the same music, I'm assuming.
Yeah.
But that, seeing them at that gig, because I had heard them before, and I was like, fuck, they're unbelievable. But he is the exact, like, do you remember Gallows?
I've never listened to him.
That was Frank Carter before he was Frank Carter, right? He was the lead singer at Gallows. So much heavier.
Yeah.
But when he started doing Frank Carter, he's got this accent and it's not like Sheffield or anything. It's like his proper English accent and it never leaves his songs. And it's good for that reason.
They were fucking great live.
They were fucking
bad. Is he not from London?
I think he's from East London. I think that is the accent. He's got because I don't think he's Cockney, I'm not sure. But my thing about him is he doesn't give a fuck.
What I like,
he was like they spent the whole of their set and the crowd.
Yeah,
so we do.
They
it
do
was,
that.
It was metal.
Him and the guitar player.
Aye,
they crawl out into the crowd, but what they didn't do at that gig, what they normally do at gigs, is they actually have an all-female crowd surf and mosh pit.
They did do that? I remember that.
I had a few pints.
I was driving, so I only had six.
They, that's the legal limit. You're on the south?
No.
You're on the south?
You're on the south.
You're on the south.
I don't condone drink driving. I don't do it.
No,
but you can do driving drunk.
Never ever take the tin and look carry.
Never ever
finish it before you get on.
Never ever drink a joyride.
But the
did you say never ever drink and ride?
No, drink a joyride.
All right.
Never ever drink a joyride. It was the call get us a year ago.
I still have his last voicemail. Yo,
Opera. What's your favorite show you've ever done?
I'm not a doctor.
Favorite show I've ever done?
Yeah.
Zanzibar in Liverpool. Wow.
Good.
Sorry, that was a good gig. I forgot that one existed too.
We went in and we were just taken by the venue alone because it looked like it was like it. Yeah, I think you have played it. I was chatting to Dylan about this. It was like, you know, while I'm old school awnings like you would have seen in clubs in LA. Yeah. One of them and then a blue neon sign that said Zanzibar and then the rest of it was black, red. Nice. Went inside, the whole venue was black. There was lights behind the bar and there was fairy lights going around the ceiling and that was it. Big ass stage. And then the sound engineer had like a 127 channel analog desk.
It was Starship Enterprise.
His name was Richard and he was full. And I was like, oh no. Like, this is going to be shite. Like,
yeah.
Got set up. I can't remember who the bands we were playing along with were, but I remember one of them was so young their parents were there.
No, it wasn't they were so young and their parents was there. It's that they were managed by one of their fathers.
Yeah.
And he came from money.
Yeah, that's what it was.
I hate that shit.
Yeah, they were. They were.
They had the best of gear, no talent, God bless them.
So they were a young indie band, and they played, and it was grand, right? They fell out after it. And then there was another band on the bill that we actually really got on with, and they were like a bit heavier. So it was like that gradient of it was getting heavier. And we went on, and I genuinely, last day, do not know where that crowd came out of. But the place, all of a sudden, was jammed.
Lethal.
And there was a mosh pit going on in front of us. Yeah. And we were like, I never want to leave this venue.
By the end of it, they knew a couple of choruses too, and that was the first time that happened for me, and that kind of caught me in the heart. Like,
I think that happened for all. It went that well that for the first time on the tour, we booked a hotel room that evening to stay in. In North Wales.
Rel?
No, Holyhead.
Holyhead, right.
But and that's evidently where I got my speeding point.
We could not get out of Liverpool for love or money.
Jesus Christ.
We got lost in Liverpool.
I fell out with Santa. Genuinely thought it was that. She was like, go down the road, go right.
Do you not just use like Google Maps?
Aye.
Alright.
Went down the road and went to go right, and I was like, you can't go right. So every 10 minutes it was take a U-turn, take a U-turn, take a U-turn. So I swapped off Google Maps, the iPhone's version of Maps, and it got us out of there.
Apple Maps?
Aye.
Oh, that's dreadful.
Google was shitting itself for some reason. Oh, I don't know why. There must have been so many traffic updates, it was just panicking.
I'd be constantly getting all the done for walking away places with Apple Maps. Like, download Google Maps, please.
Turn it up for the sake of the boys.
Don's the kind of person who'll walk down two streets and get lost 10 streets away.
To be fair, I remember playing fucking the Irish Youth Music Awards.
I think we done that.
We lost Avenue in Dublin, and I remember getting lost. we were going for breakfast before and all, and I just remember getting lost and then landing back. And then, this is how you know you're young and naive. I just assumed that every guitar amp on the planet had distortion. Except for mine at that gig.
Nice.
And it was like, me and Dolan were like flipping a coin. There was two amps. It was a Marshall and a Fender. And Fender had no distortion.
You were flipping for distortion.
And we were flipping for distortion. Dolan got it. So you can actually watch that video somewhere. It was in Dublin. My guitar is clean.
Sounds like a Shreds video.
Like, I go for the guitar solo. And it's like...
smooth. John Mayer's playing lead, boy. Holy fuck.
It's supposed to be like... da-na-na-na-na-na. And it's like... ding, 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 ding. But the only thing about it is... and this might be my memory. I might be wrong. I'm nearly sure we got terribly, terribly stoned beforehand. And I just don't look up from my feet the whole gig. Like, I just stare at my feet.
Yeah.
The whole gig. Like, all you see is a mop of hair. That was I done. And I remember my cable being that short too. The stage was massive and I couldn't really wander far away from my amp. Dalton's playing somebody's bass. I don't even know whose bass it was. Like a big blue Yamaha bass. That's the gigs I miss.
Like answer to me now. The metal
you're so unprepared for it. And it's just because there was a good crowd at that.
Like, we used to play...
it was another version of Battle of the Bands.
Oh man, the many Battle of the Bands.
Because we qualified in the YM for that.
I think you've done what me and like my first ever gig was.
It was
the same thing, like.
In the YM. And then
we played the YM and Mickey Bradley was judging.
I think Mickey Bradley George George as well. Yeah. Mickey doesn't get out much. God love him.
Oh, bring the two sides together.
He's flat out with the Undertones.
Oh, he's flat out with a Peace Bridge.
Oh, yeah. He is flat out with the Undertones, but
the Undertones are still fucking...
A friend of ours is his uncle. Is the drummer.
Right.
And I always assumed Davey Whiteside was the drummer. Nowadays.
No.
Davey's definitely stood in, but...
yeah.
And I just assumed, and then I was chatting with his friend, and he's like, no, he's flat out with Undertones. I was like, where? where?
We played Newcastle County Down last year. It was a big festival, and the Undertones were headlining that.
I know Touts and Tramp done a show with I think it was the Millennium Forum,
yeah,
not that long ago with them.
Mm.
Which
still going strong.
Makes so much sense.
I like them.
I love their attitude. Like, their whole, like, we don't care if we're older. We're just doing it anyway.
That's great.
And it's the fact that if you go to a Derry match, their song is still being chanted.
Oh, we played it.
You have to know that's a thing. That's right, so you did. You have to know that's a thing. Like, that's how you know you've made a hit.
Aye. Oh, yeah.
When 20-odd years later, people are still singing it.
Aye.
My favourite lyric that Fergal Sharkey just did not write is I want to hold her dick because fun herbs are fucking shit. That makes my whole evening every time I hear it. I go, that's fantastic. Leave it to dairy fans. Wait, Rovers.
Huh? Love a good dairy match.
I love a good dairy match.
Great.
I don't know any of the players. I just like watching.
Yeah.
And shouting abuse at lower teams.
Right.
That's
I've been to one and the atmosphere is delightful.
And it's the one I think it was.
It's an atmosphere of violence.
It was nearly fucking December. I was in it last year. Like, it was mad.
Yeah.
Is she getting told off for not going to work today?
Probably.
That's 100% what that is.
Yeah. Well, he told me not to go on.
So. You think you want to plug while we're here?
Plug?
Fuck. Don loves a good bit.
Was he plugging on the last one?
When Don was here, Don had the plug ready.
He read it?
Like on
script.
The phone, he had the plug ready. Like, the best part is, the whole thing, Don was like, here.
Yeah.
Don was like, we're going to blah, 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 whatever. See the man at the plug game? We're playing on that. Right up, like right on his face.
It was magic. Like, he just produced a shirt and tie and all. Like, they started reading as I was on the news.
The best.
Oh, he's a pro. Don's a pro.
What is next for
us?
Yeah, well, he's writing an album too. But what's next?
When are we playing again?
We playing again?
Drummers. I'm the worst, man. Fucking like, I drive the tours and all, and I have Don will tell me where we're going in the morning. Like.
You're me.
So like,
is he fuck? What? You're anal as fucking organized up the wazoo.
Aye, but I drive all those.
Yeah. That's fair.
I drive everywhere.
But you're not lackadaisy.
I do nothing.
Yeah, I'm Dylan. I'm flat out. Like, yeah. I do all the organising.
I'm about you. I like the way you operate.
I do, Dylan will just be like, we've got a gig here. And I'm like, right, let's go.
You show up.
Yeah.
How long did I change my t-shirt and my socks?
Right, well, because Michael doesn't know, I think your next gig is the 28th.
Of October, yeah. That's the next
of
one.
October.
Yeah. That is the next one.
Where is it?
Sandino's.
And then you've Halloween gig.
Yeah.
Bennigan's. And then there'll be more shows after that.
Can I do a bit of plugging?
I'm pretty I don't know nothing, but I'm pretty sure Dylan's booking like tours upon tours upon tours. Because that's all we know how to do.
He's going
to
Elvis you.
Yeah.
Work you to your dad.
I've been just piggybacking off him for 10 years.
Well, their Nando's don't want you back. more holidays than fucking Santa. Yeah.
I know, I'm glad I drive tours because it's fucking cut the drinking on tours.
It keeps you sober. Well, I kind of like that too, except for when we were in Wrexham and they gave us a whole fridge full of beer.
Destroyed them.
Like, they gave us a green room and then they were like, I was looking at this fridge in the green room going, I wonder can we have that? They were like, that's for you. And there was like a full fridge of fucking beer and we were like, oh.
We have been in some absolute states in tour, like. Especially when we used to get somebody to drive us. When we play Newcastle, we always stay with this family called the Dixons.
Mm.
The nicest people on earth. This is a good one though. We stay in Newcastle. We always stay with the Dixons.
Yeah,
they're fucking class.
This renowned family.
They're amazing, amazing people. But the first night we stayed there, we were an hour band staying there. We were called As It Is. We're pretty really big pop punk band.
I know that band.
Yeah,
Paddy Walters. Paddy Walters. Huh?
Yeah, and so we were staying with Lemons and their drummer at the time. Like, we were all having a bit of crack and drinking and all, and it got a wee bit out of hand. Everybody just kept drinking, and then. Foley was like, I can out drink yous.
Oh no.
And we were like, I don't think you can. And he goes, no, I can out drink yous definitely. I'm part Irish. And we were like, that's besides the point, like, but no, you can't.
Right, so now that we've
You hate the genetics, but we hate the practice.
now that we've got over your racist stereotype, crack a can back down.
But we just drank all night then, and like, so the thing was like, first to go to bed, loses just it's just the way it was. And I got there about half five in the morning. And everybody's standing around steaming, and Foley was all to me. I can bid you in a push-up challenge, and I was like, "He's a big lad, like." He's a firefighter now, like. And I was like, "No, you can't." And he goes, "I can beat you in a push-up challenge." I was like, "Can you fuck?" And the two of us just stood up and kicked the chairs out of the way in the kitchen, like kicked the chairs out of the way, and got down, and fucking giving it all to you, like. And then he stopped, and I kept going. And their tour driver at the time, he was drinking with us as well. He's like, "He fucking beat you, and all he beat you." And they just shut up, and he goes, I can fucking fight though. And I was all, let's go. So we ended up, we were out the Dixon's backyard, and me and Foley had our tops off, and we were fucking bobbing and weaving and all. And
I love that you brought the Irish gypsy to England.
So we were like,
you know that, mate, I'll beat you.
We were fucking rode off, like, and then it got to about six, half six in the morning, and Amy, the daughter, the two people that live there, she was getting up for work and she came down and she's like, what the fuck is going on? Like me and Foley were in the fucking...
Squaring off.
And I swung and he swung and he punched me and I was fucking blocked and I was just all, I think I'm done. I don't fancy, like, the drink to the head is enough. Like, I don't need a punch on top of it. Like, and they all was fucking... And we ended up... I think it's the only time ever they've had a noise complaint from the neighbours.
Jesus.
Because...
Because Paddy was fighting in the backyard.
John McGinley.
Foley eventually went to bed, and I was like, "Thank fuck!" And I when you come out of the kitchen, you had the hallway to go up the stairs, the rooms. No. I didn't even make it the stairs; just fell asleep in the hallway. I literally just fell beside the radiator and passed out.
Poor family.
And Dylan and fucking Dalton were out the back playing Three Lions.
Jesus Christ!
Class.
Right, fuck it. We'll round her up there.
Yeah.
Michael's band Parker has an album out called Never Miss.
Never Let This Go.
Never Let This Go. The singles Never Miss, isn't it?
Yeah.
One of them. It's got multiple singles. You can get it on Spotify, Bandcamp, fucking Deezer.
Wherever you get your fucking Tidal. Steal it. Illegally download it.
Straight
on
SoundCloud. Y2MP3 downloader from download.
Remember BitTorrent?
Adam has got
a single called Kindness out.
Kindness.
It's about murdering your best friend because he's a prick when you go on holidays. Isn't that right, Reese?
Yep. I think he should have called Blindness, but alright. And Black Lanterns have a show coming up on the 29th of this month in Bennigan's. So if you want to come, that'll be this weekend when this podcast comes out.
When's that?
Is that the 29th?
Is that the final?
That's the final.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Let's get ready to rumble.
If you want to come along and show your support and all that there, Craig. There's no rumble, I'm going for the crack. And you know what? You're driving that night, I'm getting full.
Sweet!
Little.
Can I borrow the car?
No. Oh. You drive the car with me in it.
Yeah.
Can we borrow the car?
No, you put your faith in me. And that'll do it. Fuck it. Good luck.
Good luck.
Fuck off.